In this lesson, we will discuss Pascal's law. Imagine a small fluid element that has lengths dx, dy, dz, and a density rho. The fluid element's total mass is dm, and its volume is dv. There are two types of forces that can act on this fluid element. Body forces, such as gravity, act on all parts of the fluid element. The resultant gravitational force acts at the center of mass and points downward. Since the fluid element is very small, we will call this force dFg. The magnitude of the gravitational force is the mass dm times the gravitational acceleration g. The mass dm is equal to the density times the volume. There are also forces that act at the surfaces of the fluid element. For clarity, we will only show the forces acting on three of the six surfaces. We can decompose the surface forces into three orthogonal components. One component acts perpendicular or normal to the surface, and two components act tangentially to the surface. There are many systems in fluid mechanics where there is no relative motion between different fluid elements. That is, the fluid elements do not slide against each other and the fluid would appear static. Since there is no sliding motion at the surface of the fluid elements, there will be no shear stresses at those surfaces. This occurs in two situations. In the first situation, the fluid is not accelerating. That is, the fluid is either stationary or moving with constant velocity. For these systems, the surface of the fluid would remain horizontal. In the second situation, a fluid moves with constant acceleration. If the tank was initially at rest, sloshing would occur. But once the sloshing dies down, although the surface would not be horizontal, it would be still, and the fluid elements would not slide against each other. In both these situations, a fluid element only experiences normal forces at the surface due to pressure and a gravitational body force. Since pressure forces act on all sides of a fluid element, we need to know if pressure varies with direction. We start by examining the forces on a small triangular prism of fluid of arbitrary angle theta. The dimensions of the prism are dy by dz by dl. The prism has a mass dm and a volume dv, and we will assume the density is a uniform value of rho throughout the prism. The gravitational force, dFg, acts in the negative z direction, and pressure forces act normal to the surfaces. dF1 acts on the left side, dF2 acts on the top side, and dF3 acts on the bottom side. There are pressure forces acting on the front and back sides as well, but including them in the diagram would clutter the image, and we would obtain the exact same results whether or not we included them in the analysis. So we omit the forces on the front and back sides for clarity. Since pressure is equal to force per area, we can rewrite dF as pressure times dA. So dF1 becomes P1 times the area dx times dz. dF2 becomes P2 times the area dx times dl. And dF3 becomes P3 times the area dx times dy. We also can rewrite dFg as dm times g. Newton's second law in the y direction states that the sum of the forces in the y direction is equal to the mass of the fluid element times the acceleration of the fluid element in the y direction. Substituting the values for forces and mass, we get P1 times dx dz minus the y component of the pressure force on the top face, which is P2 times dx dl sine theta, equals dm times ay. Newton's second law in the z direction states that the sum of forces in the z direction is equal to the mass of the fluid element times the acceleration of the fluid element in the z direction. Substituting the values for forces and the mass, we get P3 times dx dy minus the z component of the pressure force on the top face, P2 times dx dl cosine theta, minus dm times g equals dm times az. For this analysis, we will not apply Newton's second law in the x direction, as the symmetric pressure forces would cancel out. Had we examined Newton's second law in the x direction, it would not change our conclusions. We can rewrite dl and dm in terms of other quantities. dl times sine theta is equal to dz, dl times cosine theta is equal to dy, and dm is equal to the density rho times the volume dv. The volume of a triangular prism is equal to 1/2 the volume of a rectangular prism. Divide the first equation by dx dz, and divide the second equation by dx dy. The two equations of motion simplify to p1 minus p2 equals rho ay times 1/2 dy, and p3 minus p2 equals the quantity rho g plus rho az times 1/2 dz. We'll put the two equations of motion on the top of the screen and re-show the prism. In the limit dx, dy, and dz go to 0, the prism becomes an infinitely small point in space, and the right side of the equations disappear. For a point in space, p1 is equal to p2, and p3 is equal to p2. This means that p1, p2, and p3 are equal to each other. In other words, pressure is isotropic, or independent of direction, if no shearing forces exist. This implies that pressure is a scalar quantity, not a vector, and we call this result Pascal's law. Since the angle theta was arbitrary, Pascal's law applies for any fluid element and is a general conclusion about static fluids.